talk because I've been doing a lot of talks about Christmas cookies lately, and it's not even Thanksgiving yet. So I'm happy to talk about pumpkin pie with my talk, As American as Pumpkin Pie, from colonial New England to pumpkin spice lattes, right? Pumpkin is so ubiquitous kind of throughout American history, and it really is more American than apple pie. So we'll be talking about all of that and all the ways in which pumpkin has kind of become this very distinctly American flavor that's not necessarily associated with the United States globally. So pumpkin is indigenous to the Americas. It dates back about 7,500 years ago to the Oaxacan Highlands in Mexico. It spreads throughout North and parts of South America to indigenous communities as part of an agricultural system called the Three Sisters, which is where you are growing corn, pumpkins, and pole beans in the same plot, and they have a very symbiotic relationship. So corn is a very important grain crop, but it needs a lot of nutrients. Pumpkins are nitrogen fixing, so they're giving the corn plant nitrogen, and then they're also climbing up the corn stalk, right? Because they're pole beans. And then the pumpkins have very broad leaves. So if you plant them at the base of the corn, they're shading the soil, they're keeping the soil moist, preventing water from evaporating and the soil from drying out. And they're also keeping weeds or other plants you don't want competing with your crops from growing. Those three foods, once the corn and the beans are dry, they keep for a very long time. And pumpkin is also an excellent storage fruit because it is technically a fruit. When our European colonists first come to the Americas, right, especially in New England with the Pilgrims or the Separatists, as they're called in England, they arrive in like October. Winter is coming and they are totally unprepared. They are not used to the climate. They don't know how to grow food in New England. And then also in Virginia, in Jamestown, a lot of those early colonists were like, you know, second sons of wealthy families. Everybody wanted to get rich. Nobody wanted to grow food. And so they kind of had to adapt to and adopt indigenous foodways as a way to survive. And so it's this kind of intimate knowledge of these indigenous foods that help save a lot of these colonists from starvation. So the pumpkin becomes a very important food in colonial New England in particular. It's very well suited to the growing conditions in that area. Pumpkin does need a certain number of warm days in the summer, but it is also very cold hardy and it stores very well if you keep it cool and dry. A lot of the early pumpkins or squash, which they're in kind of the same family. Pumpkin is actually not a botanical term like squash is. But a lot of those early varieties had very, very thick, very hard skin. So they kept for a very, very long time. They're also very easy to cook on the hearth. You can cook whole pumpkins in ash. You can stew pumpkins. You can boil them, right? You can roast them in a Dutch oven. So they were easy to cook, easy to store. A pumpkin will give a lot of food. They're relatively easy to grow. Anybody who's tried to grow pumpkins, maybe they've taken over your yard. So they really become this kind of staple backbone food in early colonial New England. And we get pumpkin pie pretty early on, although the first pumpkin pie is not recorded in the Americas, it's recorded in France. And it's a little bit different than we would typically bake it. So this is a French recipe. It's a pumpkin tourte, right? They're saying to boil the pumpkin with milk, good milk meaning not sour milk, pass it through a straining pan very thick, so you're pureeing it, mix it with sugar, butter, a little salt, if you will, a few stamped almonds, that means ground almonds, let it all be very thin, so kind of liquidy. Put in your sheet of paste, your pie crust, bake it after it is baked, besprinkle with sugar, and serve. So that sounds pretty much similar to what we make today, although we don't usually put ground almonds in our pumpkin pies, and this is missing the egg, so it's maybe not that custardy. So this dates back to 1651 in France, and then it is translated for the British market in 1653. Hannah Woolley in The Queen-Like Closet, she is one of the more famous British cookbook authors. Hers is very different. The French one was similar to what we have now. Hers is very different. So she's saying, take a pumpkin and pare it or peel it, right? Cut it in thin slices, dip the slices in beaten eggs and herbs, then fry it till it be enough, right? Until it's cooked, typical of the time period. Then lay it into a pie with butter, raisins, currants, sugar, and sack, which is a type of wine. And in the bottom, I'm like, she's done that first, Hannah. In the bottom, some sharp apples, right? Some sour apples. When it is baked, butter it and serve it in. So you're going to add even more butter to it. So, you know, it's like fried slices of pumpkin with apple, raisins, currants, and wine. So not necessarily how we are used to thinking about pumpkin pie. And then we get to Amelia Simmons. Amelia Simmons' American Cookery was published in 1796. It's considered the first American cookbook. There were other cookbooks in the Americas prior to her, but this is the first one published in the United States for an American audience, written in the United States, published in the United States for an American audience. And part of the revolution of that cookbook was all of the American ingredients, including pumpkin. So she has a couple of puddings, she calls them, even though they're baked in a crust. So one is pumpkin pudding number one is you take a quart of stewed and strained pumpkin, 3 pints of cream, that's almost 1-to-1 ratio of pumpkin and cream, 9 eggs, sugar, mace, nutmeg, ginger, that's familiar. Laid into a paste or a pie crust. She gives you options. She has a number of pie crust recipes in there. And with a dough spur, cross and checker it. So it's got like a lattice top, baked in dishes 3/4 of an hour. Pumpkin pudding number two is a little simpler. It's one a recipe I've made, turned out very nicely. It's 1/4 milk, 1 pint of stewed and strained pumpkin, 4 eggs, molasses, allspice, ginger in a crust and bake 1 hour. So the primary difference between these two recipes is that this one is way more expensive, right? So you not only have a ton of cream and eggs, we also have mace and nutmeg, which are from the same plant, which are much more expensive than allspice and ginger, right? And then it's got 1 million eggs, it's 9 eggs instead of 4. This is using milk instead of cream, right? So still in a pie crust, but only a bottom crust, not with the lattice on top. So one is much fancier, one is more for every day. And then we have Lady Maria Child. Lady Maria Child is one of my favorite cookbook authors. She only published one cookbook, The Frugal Housewife, in 1829, which then when she publishes it in England gets renamed the American Frugal Housewife in the 1830s. She's a fascinating person. She was a literary writer. She also was an abolitionist. She was in favor of Native American rights. She was editor of one of the first magazines published in the United States specifically for children called Juvenile Miscellany. And she actually basically resigns from that job after the publication in 1833 of an appeal in favor of that class of Americans called Africans, because there was a lot of readership in the South and they did not like that she was an abolitionist. So she resigns and a woman named Sarah Josepha Hale takes over as editor for a year or so to try and save the publication, but it ultimately folds. And we'll talk more about Sarah Josepha Hale later. So Lady Maria Child, her most enduring legacy is actually not her cookbook. It's the New England Boy's Song of Thanksgiving, which she published in a book of children's poetry. This poem is also known as Over the River and Through the Woods. It's much longer than, you know, we usually just know Over the River and Through the Woods to Grandmother's House We Go. So the end of it is Over the River and Through the Wood, when Grandmother sees us come, she will say, "Oh dear, the children are here. Bring a pie for everyone. On the river, over the river and through the wood, now Grandmother's cap I spy. Hurrah for the fun, is the pudding done? Hurrah for the pumpkin pie," right? So this illustration is actually Grandma with a giant pudding, right? A steamed or boiled pudding. But it's a fairly early reference to pumpkin pie in association with Thanksgiving. This is her recipe. I have also made this one and her paste recipe. It's a long and complicated recipe, but it's written in paragraph form like a lot of these recipes are. So she's giving you instructions as if she were standing next to you, basically. So she's saying, for common family pumpkin pies, 3 eggs do very well to a quart of milk. So she's giving you a ratio. Stew your pumpkin and strain it through a sieve or colander. Take out the seeds and pare the pumpkin or squash before you stew it, but do not scrape the inside. The part nearest the seed is the sweetest part of the squash. Stir the stewed pumpkin till it is as thick as you can stir it round rapidly and easily, right? So you're cooking off a lot of the water in the pumpkin. If you want to make your pie richer, make it thinner and add another egg, right? So she's saying add a little more milk and another egg. 1 egg to a quart of milk makes very decent pies, right? So she's saying if you can't afford 3 eggs, right, or you're making a bunch of pies and you don't have enough eggs, you could do the ratio of 1 egg to a quart of milk. Sweeten it to your taste with molasses or sugar. Some pumpkins require more sweetening than others. 2 teaspoonfuls of salt, 2 great spoonfuls of sifted cinnamon. So you're grinding your own cinnamon. So you got to sift those bark pieces out. 1 great spoonful of ginger. Ginger will answer very well alone for spice if you use enough of it. The outside of a lemon, grated, is nice, which is calling for a lemon zest, if you want. The more eggs, the better the pie. Some put an egg to a gill of milk. They should bake from 40 to 50 minutes and even 10 minutes longer if very deep. So if you have a very deep pie plate, you're supposed to bake it for longer. So that's pretty straightforward, right? Even though it's this long, kind of intimidating paragraph, she's kind of walking you through all the options you have for baking different types of pumpkin pie. And I have made this one and it also turned out very good, despite the kind of vague instructions. So we got a little bit of a taste with our, no pun intended, with our pumpkin pie recipes of the types of spicing we're doing with pumpkin pie, right? And so what is pumpkin spice? That's a term we use a lot today. Pumpkin spice technically dates back to medieval Europe, even though they were not using it to flavor pumpkin. Really, medieval Europe, we're getting our spice over the Silk Road. Arab traders are trading with the Chinese, with India, with the Spice Islands, and then bringing it back to the Mediterranean through Venice. Venice becomes so wealthy from the spice trade, it basically, that wealth fuels the Renaissance. And then in the 16th century, so the 1500s, other countries in Europe are kind of fed up with the Venetian and Arab monopoly on spice. So they try to start circumventing. And you get people like the Dutch, like the English, like the Portuguese, essentially invading the Spice Islands and forcibly taking them over. It's pretty brutal. If you're interested in the history, in particular of nutmeg, which kind of took Europe by storm, there's a very readable history called Nathaniel's Nutmeg that goes into a lot of that early and somewhat brutal history. By the 18th century, spice was much more affordable because it was coming in much larger quantities by ship instead of overland. And also there were a number of spices discovered in the Caribbean, right? So it's a lot easier for people to access, But some spices are cheaper than others. Black pepper and ginger and cinnamon are much cheaper than, say, nutmeg or even cloves. Nutmeg is the most dear because historically it was indigenous only to the Spice Islands and only to a few of the Spice Islands. But in the late 18th and early 19th century, they start to cultivate it in other tropical locales, which makes it more affordable. So by the time we get to the 19th century, a lot of these spices are quite cheap compared to how they used to be. So you get the proliferation of, like gingerbread and spice cookies and spice cake, things like that, that are available. But then we start to get pumpkin spice, right? So pumpkin spice, the definition, typically it's a mixture of cinnamon, ginger, cloves, allspice, nutmeg, and mace. And nutmeg and mace are from the same plant. Nutmeg is the nut of the plant, and mace is like this casing around the outside of the nutmeg. So interestingly, pumpkin pie spice is not nearly as old as pumpkin pie, at least not the name pumpkin pie spice. In 1930, Thompson and Taylor Spice Company is the first that we have record of mixing all these spices together in one container and calling it pumpkin pie spice, right? Then in 1934, McCormick gets in the game. And pumpkin pie spice and pumpkin spice are pretty much the same thing. And it's called pumpkin pie spice because it was initially developed specifically to spice pumpkin pies, which called at the time for a lot of mixture of spices, not just one or two, although you could do one or two, like, our cookbook authors suggest. But the traditional mixture is quite a lot, and spice companies kind of capitalized on that. So this is a 1933 ad for TNT Pumpkin Spice. And this woman is saying, "Mother, why is it your pumpkin pies are never failures?" And her elderly mother, who's mixing something up, says, "TNT pumpkin pie spice, my dear, makes them perfect every time." So they're, talking about, "Oh, it's all perfectly blended, whatever." And so they're saying, "Oh, you wouldn't want to buy nine specific spices just to make a pumpkin pie. But here we've mixed them, this proprietary blend up for you," right? So it was a way for companies to kind of market a new product and make it more inviting for American housewives by saying, "Oh, look, we're going to make it so much easier for you. It's already the correct blend of spices. You just have to measure it out and pop it in," right? This is McCormick with their pumpkin pie and gingerbread spice, which I love. But, yeah, of course, it's most of the same spices in both things. So why wouldn't you market them together? So theirs is a blend of ginger, cinnamon, nutmeg, cloves, and other spices, right? They never want to give you the whole list because they don't want you to replicate it at home, right? So that's kind of the origin of pumpkin pie spice. Although I have to wonder if what would our life be like if we called it gingerbread spice, right? Canned pumpkin really helps revolutionize how Americans are consuming pumpkin. So throughout the 18th and 19th century, people are processing their own pumpkin, right? Which if you're using some of those really tough skinned ones, you gotta like have like a hatchet to cut them open. That was very typical in kind of the early days. But we are getting innovations in pumpkin breeding. We're getting innovations in canning throughout the 19th century, especially after the American Civil War. There's this proliferation of canning companies, and they're just canning every kind of fruit and vegetable you can imagine, including pumpkin and squash. Libby's is probably our most famous canned pumpkin brand these days. They're founded just after the American Civil War in Chicago, to can corned beef, which you can still buy, which is like, they would take up the scraps from the meat packing plants that were, perfectly good meat, but too small to really do anything with, and they would turn it into corned beef. They expanded in the 1880s to fruits and vegetables, and their canned pumpkin is actually a very special kind of squash called Dickinson squash. It's very sweet, very smooth. got a very fine grain texture. It's related to butternut squash, which surprises some people. But like I said, pumpkin is not a botanical designation. So it can be not, you know, all pumpkins are squashes, but not all squashes are pumpkins, that kind of a thing. And then we also get the development of today, you can still get a canned pumpkin and squash from a company called One Pie, which is originally the Metamac Canning Company, which I could find very little about. It's a mystery. I think they date back to sometime in the 19th century. They're based in Maine. So some Mainas swear by One Pie instead of Lippy. But those are the two most popular. And then of course you have all kinds of generic and organic and other brands. But those two are the ones that kind of people are the most passionate about. Once we get canned pumpkin, people start to use it for other stuff, right? It is a very convenient product. The very earliest canned pumpkins were actually chunks of pumpkin canned in water or syrup, because it is very difficult to get a solid, basically a solid paste canned safely, right? But once we start to get that technology, it really takes off in use in the 1930s, 40s, 50s, especially in the latter half of the 20th century. We get pumpkin cake, pumpkin bread, pumpkin bars, right? People are moving beyond pie, pumpkin cheesecake, all that fun stuff. And it's almost all relying on canned pumpkin. So this is just a great little advertisement from Libby's. I said the first one I ever found that I could date back to, I think it's 1915. Their pumpkin pie recipe was actually to sell their evaporated milk. They didn't have canned pumpkin at that point. But this is the very typical advertisement. They're like, look, it's so easy. You can get a pie crust mix. And then, you know, we'll tell you how to mix up the pumpkin and then pour it in. And hello, you've got pumpkin pie. And then this is just, I couldn't find any historic advertisements for One Pie. So these are modern cans, although they look vintage, which I think is part of the charm. But they have both squash and pumpkin, and they've got a slice of pumpkin pie right on there. Libby's does not have an actual pumpkin like we think of, like the round pumpkin on there, because that's not how Dickinson squashes are shaped. So they usually have a slice of pie on theirs as well. So in the 30s, as I said, we started to get the development of some other pumpkin ingredients. So this is a 1935 recipe for pumpkin spice cake, right? So we're making a cake with pumpkin spice. It does call for canned pumpkin. Then it's got cloves, nutmeg, cinnamon, right? And then very typical of early 20th century recipes, we got to put chopped dates in it, right? That's a thing. So and since Thanksgiving is coming up, I thought we'd talk about pumpkin pie and the quote unquote first Thanksgiving, of which there are a lot of myths. So a lot of people like to talk about the first Thanksgiving. It's the fall of 1621, might be December of 1621 actually. And they're, you know, the pilgrims are celebrating a successful harvest after a horrible winter. And they're firing their guns in the air because they're so excited. And the Wampanoag nearby were like, are you guys firing at us? Like, are you getting ready to start a war? Because that was a thing that happened a lot. So they showed up with a whole bunch of warriors and were like, hey, what's going on? And the pilgrims are like, oh, you way outnumber us and you're armed. Why don't you come and have dinner with us? And so that's kind of what they did. Not what we think of as Thanksgiving food today. They did not have a bake oven at that time. They had no wheat flour or any other European grains. They only had cornmeal, and there were no dairy cattle. So there's no dairy. They may have had eggs from fowl that they had brought over. They might have had turkey, not super clear. They say they shot wild fowl. More likely that it was a wild duck or wild geese. The Wampanoag brought four deer, so they had venison. They probably also had some shellfish. That was very abundant and common food at that time. Definitely no green bean casserole. That is a 20th, mid-20th century invention. Maybe they had cranberries, maybe. Probably they had pumpkin, but it was probably stewed as a side dish and not as a dessert because, again, they didn't have any flour, they couldn't make pies. So the other issue is that the first Thanksgiving is not really the first Thanksgiving, and it's not necessarily associated with the harvest season as it comes to be later. Thanksgivings were religious festivals or religious events, community events to, give thanks to God for some event or some success. They could happen any time of year for any reason. This one just happened to coincide with the harvest because they were thankful for a successful harvest. It's really not until the late 18th, early 19th century that we start to get a closer association of religious festivals of Thanksgiving with the harvest. And it's really not until the mid-19th century, really post-Civil War, when we're trying to define who we are as a nation, what it means to be American, that we really start looking back at things like the first Thanksgiving and building up all kinds of mythology around them from 1914, which is not accurate at all. Yeah, pumpkin was present. It was probably stewed. It may have been roasted whole. They might have had honey. Doubtful. Honey beans are not indigenous to the Americas, but if they brought honey beans with them, they might have had some honey. I already talked about some of this stuff. So it's related to British harvest festivals, Plymouth being the first Thanksgiving. And then, oh, who's that? It's Sarah Josepha Hale. Right, the woman who took over as editor of Juvenile Miscellany for Lydia Maria Child. She is really the reason why we have a national Thanksgiving holiday. She spends over 20 years trying to convince Americans as a whole to adopt this very deeply New England holiday. She first describes Thanksgiving in her very popular 1920, sorry, 1826. 26 or 27 novel Northwood, where she describes the Thanksgiving feast with turkey at the centerpiece. There's also like leg of pork and leg of mutton and beef sirloin and chicken pie and all these other foods too. She is editor of Godey's Ladies Book for a very long time. That was a very influential women's magazine, primarily directed at fashion, but also at just, ordinary householding advice columns, stuff like that. So she starts a letter writing campaign. She's constantly talking about Thanksgiving and her editorial role at Godey's Ladies Book. And she eventually convinces Abraham Lincoln in the middle of the American Civil War to make Thanksgiving. He proclaims it that it's a national holiday. Of course, the country is very divided at that point. It is a very New England holiday. It's really not celebrated outside of New England or new territories where emigrants from New England had settled. But it becomes this national holiday. And at the end of the 19th century, into the 20th century, it becomes part of this effort to create an American identity, which, because of where the population was centered and because of how our history was recorded, becomes part of something I call New England supremacy, which is very closely tied to white supremacy, right? That there's this idea that, the founding of our nation was based on, being welcoming and hospitality and this kind of mythological dinner that did not happen how we learned in school that it happened, right? Thanksgiving starts to get more and more popular nationally in the 20th century. We had the first Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade in 1924. It starts to be celebrated outside of New England in the late 19th century. We get the proliferation of some regional differences, largely in side dishes and especially stuffing, right? All different kinds of stuffing depending on where you're living. And then FDR officially sets a Thanksgiving date of the fourth Thursday in November, and he really does it to help out our retailers for Christmas shopping, right? It's called Black Friday, because that is the day that retailers go from being in the red or being in debt to the black, being in the black as people are doing all of their holiday shopping at the end of the year. So kind of a mercenary reason to have it, but prior to that, Thanksgivings were celebrated at different times and dates in different states and even localities. So talked a little bit about Sarah Josepha Hale. There she is. Again, she's also very famous for poetry. She wrote Mary Had a Little Lamb. She starts her letter writing campaign. She convinces Lincoln. She's also known as the mother of Thanksgiving for that reason. Just some fun images. We have this cute little circa 1920 postcard featuring a pumpkin pie. It says, "Oh, sing a song of pumpkin pies and turkeys roasted brown. Thanksgiving Day is here again, and come this year to crown. Oh, pray receive my wholesome wishes for well-prepared Thanksgiving dishes," which I think is super cute. But the pie is, this pumpkin pie is the centerpiece, right? So we talked a little bit. I talked about, you know, New England supremacy. There is a distinct cultural dominance coming out of New England, in large part because that's like the center of the American Revolution. The Civil War, really in an effort to have this homogenous identity, they kind of glom on to New England as like where the founding fathers are all from, even though George Washington's from Virginia, you know. So it's Thomas Jefferson, you know, it's kind of this mythology about the start of patriotism in the American Revolution. And so in the South, Thanksgiving was not celebrated for a long time, particularly among former Confederates who swore that it was a gross violation and a Yankee holiday and all that fun stuff. So there was, Thanksgiving used to be controversial. We don't think of it as controversial necessarily today, but it definitely was. We also, because we have this cultural dominance of New England, there is also this dominance of what is American food, right? And because New England is a British colony, we tend to adopt a lot of those British food ways. So pie is very British, right? Roast beef steak, things like that, tend to be what we associate with kind of classic 19th century American food. And there's also this weird thing with New England supremacy is that everybody in the United States seems to think that fall means that it should be cold and we should be, you know, harvesting for winter. Well, guess what? It does not. Winter in Florida and California and Arizona is not the same as winter in Maine and Minnesota and Montana. Right? It's very different. We have a lot of different biomes. There's lots of different food traditions, but Thanksgiving has kind of taken this very New England-y thing and like just superimposed it on the country, which I find very interesting. Luckily, because Thanksgiving foods are very rooted in indigenous food ways, that you do have some references to a lot of that throughout the country. Traditions in the South and the tropics, again, very different from what we normally associate with Thanksgiving here in the northern parts of the country. And I think there's some valid complaint about that, although not necessarily for the reasons that maybe the Southern Confederates were complaining about it. We do also have a fairly damaging myth with Thanksgiving, that it was this peaceful affair, that the Native people are welcoming the pilgrims and inviting them and then kind of disappearing from the scene, right? So one of the things about Thanksgiving becoming increasingly popular is we are at the height of the Indian Wars in the West. 1860s and 70s is when some of the last remaining free indigenous people who are on their, ancestral lands are being kind of removed, rounded up, put on reservations. A lot of the New England indigenous people had already been pushed out. Further west, Oklahoma in particular becomes known as Indian country, Indian territory, in large part because a number of different tribes and nations were put on reservations there. So that is also a part of this American myth-making, is that, you know, it's this peaceful transfer of power when that is not the case. So a lot of Indigenous people in the 1970s, a Wampanoag man, James, I'm forgetting his last name, started a National Day of Mourning, basically for Indigenous people to mourn the first Thanksgiving as kind of the beginning of several centuries of disease, suffering of disease, war, removal, dispossession, being forced out of their homelands. And also a number of them are reclaiming a lot of their Indigenous food ways, including pumpkin, right, which is Indigenous to the Americas. So they are saving heirloom varieties, they are cultivating heirloom varieties, and also kind of rejecting or decolonizing their food ways by removing or rejecting a lot of European foods that did not exist in the Americas prior to first contact. So no sugar, no dairy, no not native spices, right? We're not using spices from the Spice Islands. We're not using wheat or other refined grain flours. We're using Indigenous grains like corn, amaranth, wild rice, things like that. So just a really fascinating resurgence in interest in Indigenous foodways, which I personally find fascinating. We do have a competitor to pumpkin, pumpkin pie, and that is sweet potato pie, which we can thank this gentleman for, George Washington Carver. Sweet potato is not Indigenous to Africa. Sometimes people call it yam, but African yams are very different. It's a completely different species from the sweet potato, but they have very similar properties. So when people primarily were being stolen or kidnapped from West Africa and enslaved in the Caribbean and North and South America, they brought their food traditions with them, and sweet potato was one of the foods that they adapted to reflect their African food ways. Attitudes in the South, they did not like pumpkin pie, right? That is some Yankee dish that they did not want to eat. Also, there is some association in the African-American community of pumpkin with slavery, because it was a very easy crop to grow. It was used to feed enslaved people. So there are some negative associations in some communities with that. And so we have sweet potato pie, which helps is popularized by George Washington Carver. George Washington Carver was an agronomist and a botanist. And his main goal in life was to help African-American people, formerly enslaved people, be self-sufficient and feed themselves on land that was badly damaged by tobacco and especially cotton agriculture. Cotton is a very resource-intensive crop. It really depletes the soil. And so people who were trying to make a life for themselves as free people, he was doing a lot of research on how to reclaim that soil and improve the soil so that you could have a productive farm. One of the big ways to do that was to raise peanuts, right? So he didn't invent peanut butter, but he does help popularize peanuts for that reason, because they are a legume and so they're nitrogen fixing. And sweet potatoes are also good for the soil and very productive and easy to grow in the American South. So his sweet potato pie calls for sliced potatoes. Subsequent versions call for mashed. So it's a very similar texture to pumpkin pie, very similar style, same color almost, but very different. So it has a very special place in a lot of African-American communities. And that is the centerpiece of Thanksgiving, not pumpkin pie. Abby Fisher published in 1881, What Mrs. Fisher Knows About Southern Cooking. She was considered the first African-American cookbook written and published by an African-American until several years ago, when we discovered Melinda Russell's cookbook, which predates her by about 20 years. But she has a recipe for sweet potato pie. Again, it's written in paragraph form. 2 pounds of potatoes will make 2 pies. Boil the potatoes soft, peel and mash fine through a colander while hot. Add a tablespoon of butter to be mashed into the potato. Then take 5 eggs and beat the yolks and white separately, and add 1 gill of milk, gill is a half cup, sweeten to taste, flavor it with orange, right? And then add a little bit of salt, mix it all up, have only one crust, and that at the bottom, right? So it's not a top crust with just sweet potato underneath, it's crust on the bottom of the plate, put the sweet potato mixture in it, bake it quickly in a hot oven, right? That's her recipe for sweet potato pie. Sweet potato pies are so popular in a lot of communities that they are commercially produced. This is a great Library of Congress photo. They have a whole series of photos from the Sweet Potato Pie Company in Paterson, New Jersey. And so they're making all these little individually wrapped sweet potato pies. We do start to get some nostalgia, right, around Thanksgiving. I mean, Thanksgiving in general is just like all mythology and nostalgia for this kind of golden age that never really existed. It's revived in the late 19th century with the centennial, right? Starts in the Civil War, kind of the centennial gives it a little bit of a boost. But really our big colonial revival is from the 1920s through the 1940s. And then again in for the bicentennial in 1976. I think also we get to be really nostalgic whenever there's economic depression, which there definitely was in rural communities in the 20s and the rest of the country in the 1930s. And then of course in the 1940s, we're at war, right? So there's a lot of patriotism involved in that. In the 2000s, people are getting really nostalgic for sort of bygone days and homemade food and like grandma used to make, right? Like that kind of stuff is disappearing. So there's, you see a resurgence in interest in scratch cooking. And then again, more recently, since the pandemic, people have gotten back to cooking and been interested in this kind of more historic food ways. So I'm just gonna share a couple more pumpkin recipes. This is Bess Truman's, Harry Truman's wife's recipe for pumpkin pie. I love this, canned may be used if you don't have your own cooked pumpkin. She's using milk and cream instead of evaporated milk. Cinnamon, ginger, nutmeg, cloves. And she beats her egg whites separately and adds them last, which makes a little bit more fluffy filling. Nancy Reagan does pumpkin pecan pie. And again, she's giving the option of canned or mashed and cooked pumpkin. 4 eggs, right? Lady Marie Chalupy would be proud. And then she's just putting pumpkin or the pecans on top, which is interesting. So it's not really how we consider pecan pie. And then we have our pumpkin spice craze, right? This is a very 20th century thing. It starts with pumpkin spice cake, right, in the 1930s. And then in the 80s, we get this kind of coffee craft, artisanal, whatever coffee craze coming out of Seattle, right, thanks to Starbucks. In the 80s, they popularized the eggnog latte, which is just a regular latte made with eggnog instead of steam milk. And they decide in the early 2000s, they want to try some new stuff. So they introduced the peppermint mocha. And that is so popular over the winter of 2002-2003 that in the fall of 2003, they decided they want to release a new holiday flavor. They did like focus group research. They had a bunch of different flavors. I don't know, like pumpkin spice was not at the top of their list, but far outperformed in the focus groups all the other options. So that was the one they introduced in the fall of 2003. Other Seattle coffee companies had pumpkin spice lattes prior to that. So Starbucks is not the first, but they are definitely the ones who popularized it. And because it is pumpkin spice, there was not any actual pumpkin in the recipe until 2015, right? Pumpkin spice is just the spice mix. It does not necessarily contain pumpkin, which throws a lot of people off. And that kind of leads to the proliferation of pumpkin spice everything, you know, breakfast cereal, potato chips, chocolate, candies, caramels, everything has got pumpkin spice in it now. And so I find it very interesting that we go from our very historic kind of original survival indigenous food way adaptation recipe of actual pumpkin pie with spices from the Spice Islands and all the baggage that brings too, we've reduced it to a flavor that we now just associate with fall, even though most of the country does not experience fall like New England. Thanks to climate change, we might never again experience the same kind of fall that, say, the Pilgrims experienced, right? There are a lot of critiques of pumpkin spice, of it being super basic, and it's just like a white girl thing, which I find hilarious given the history around the spice trade, which was one of extreme wealth and scarcity and rarity. But now it's considered basic, so it just shows you how tastes and foodways evolve over time. So that was my whirlwind tour of pumpkin pie and pumpkin spice. I personally think that pumpkin pie is more distinctly American than apple pie, even though we have the saying American is apple pie, right? Pumpkin spice is way more American in my mind. So any questions? Did I miss any questions in the chat? Didn't see any. Oh, where'd my mouse go?
Yeah, I didn't see any in the chat yet. So if anybody has a question for Sarah and would like to put that in the chat, please feel free.
I love questions. Don't be shy. I'll unspotlight myself so we're not just staring at my giant face.
Oh, do you see the comment?
Oh, great. Yeah, sweet potato pie. Yep. It's a thing. So, oh my gosh, I just had a whole conversation with friends about macaroni and cheese at Thanksgiving, which is also a big thing, especially in African-American communities, also kind of a thing in the South. So, yep. Yeah, great. Anybody else?
This is a very quiet crowd.
It is. I'm like, what are, is this all like Lutherans sitting in the back of the church kind of a thing happening right now? That's okay. If you don't have any questions, that's fine too. Oh. Yes, you're welcome, Amy. It is a lot. I tend to do that with my talks. It's just like an explosion of information. So, ooh, squash versus pumpkin pie. That is personal preference, I think, for some people. The quality of your pie really depends on the quality of your squash or pumpkin. You can have a beautiful pumpkin-y looking pumpkin and get really mediocre pie out of it. And you can have the weirdest looking squash and get delicious, amazing pie out of it. So it really depends on what variety you're going to use. But you can make a pretty decent pumpkin pie out of a butternut squash. Yeah, Nancy, Nathaniel's nutmeg is very interesting. It's pretty dense, but it's written in a fairly readable style. So I think you'll enjoy it. Okay. Any other questions?
Oh, just to let you know, Nathaniel's nutmeg is available through the library.
Great.
I just checked. You can definitely get it. If we don't have it here, we can definitely order it for you.
Great. Yeah, he goes a lot into the kind of interesting and somewhat brutal history of European obsession with nutmeg and their involvement in the Spice Islands and the spice trade. So
awesome. Okay. Anybody else have any questions?
Last call.
If not, we just want to thank Sarah again very much for joining us tonight. It was a very informative. I really enjoyed it. I learned a lot as well. So we're really happy that you could join us tonight. And we hope that you have a wonderful Thanksgiving.
Thank you. You too. Have a good night, everybody.
All right. Good night, everyone.
Bye.
Bye.